Thank you very much, Stefan, for the invitation. So my topic is random operator theory. Who has ever seen a random operator in this audience? Okay, those people should now leave the room. Because what I'm going to talk about is really the absolute basics of random operator theory, because I envisioned that most of you will be actually probabilists and have never seen a random operator before. Okay, so what is random operator theory? Well, from the mathematical point of view, it's a topic which sits somewhere in between analysis, probability, and mathematical physics. Its motivation mainly comes from physics. So let me start somehow describing to you the physical phenomena which I want to talk about and which is very en vogue among theoretical physicists at the moment and which connects to stuff which is understood by the physicists, say, for almost 40 years now. But it took a while for mathematicians to catch up. So what are we talking about? Let's imagine a disordered quantum system. What is a disordered quantum system? Physically, this might be a semiconductor, which is doped in a disordered way. So you might think of an alloy, where you have one sort of atom at a atomic grid at a lattice, and another sort of atom taking also this positions in this lattice. In this atomic lattice, but this is done in a random way. That is a physical alloy. And what we want to physically describe is the transport properties of the electrons in such a solid. As you know, somehow if this would be perfect solid, then quantum mechanics would require you to study periodic Schrödinger operators. And what disorder now introduces into the game is that periodicity is completely destroyed and you have a random Schrödinger type operator. Now, what is the physical prediction for those systems? Well, it is what I drew somehow on my first slide. Namely, think of sort of an electron gas which is filled up to the Fermi level, never mind somehow if you understand what this is, and just put some excess electrons into the solid, just by taking a lead and pumping electrons on that point. And then what we want to see, or that's the physical phenomenon which is observed, is that in certain situations which are attached to disorder being present in the semiconductor, this excess charge cannot move. Okay? It can move a bit, it can smear out, but it cannot wander off to infinity. So it will remain forever in the vicinity in the way you put this lead. Okay. Now this is, if you think about somehow such a system from the physical point of view, this is quite in contradiction to what your professor in theoretical physics told you what will happen. Namely, if you have a typical physical system, which is an interacting electron system, then equilibrium states, which are the stationary states of the system, they spread uniformly over the energy shell. That's what's in statistical mechanics known as the ergodic hypothesis. And that requires somehow that such things can actually not happen. Okay? So when people somehow measure these things, or measure absence of transport, or as Bloch in Munich, who has a device of trapping atoms, cold atoms, in a cavity, and shooting light in this cavity, so that effectively these atoms will actually be subject to a random potential. What he observes is that on long time scale, long in the sense of an experiment can never reach an infinite time scale, but on long time scale in this experiment, once he puts initially all atoms in the left half of the cavity, you will see this step of having more atoms in the left half of the cavity for basically arbitrarily long times, as long as you can run this experiment. Okay? And this is not something in which you were taught in your physics course what will happen, because what will normally happen if you take a gas and just push everything to the left half of this chamber here, releasing it will, of course, equilibrate it. Okay? So this is the physics phenomenon. Now, mathematicians, we cannot really grasp at the moment the total sort of breadth of the whole phenomena, in the sense of that what we can really prove is that these phenomena exist in non-interacting physical systems, and that was already predicted by old works of Anderson in the 50s, and that's the phenomenon of Anderson localization. So once you switch off interaction, one calls exactly this type of behavior Anderson localization. Okay, so even if there are physicists in the audience, what you should bear in mind is that what I'm talking about is the real foundations, the mathematical foundations of a phenomenon which you now quite frequently talk about in the physics labs, which is this MBL, and that's at the moment a challenge to prove this really in rigorous terms. Okay, something for the younger generation. Now, what I want to do in my talk is, or my three talks in total is in part one, which is this lecture, I want to really go back to Anderson's old work and explain to you why indeed we have for non-interacting systems this phenomenon of localization, so absence of transport and all that. Now, this phenomenon goes with a wealth of other exciting phenomena. You could mention the quantum Hall effect. But since I thought this is much more of a probability audience, I took another aspect of this Anderson localization for non-interacting systems, which one can actually show that this goes along with, which is so-called Poisson eigenvalue statistics, and that will be the talk tomorrow. And on Wednesday, I will go a bit in the direction of showing to you what might or might not survive, or what we can at least show in certain systems which then mimic interactions. And the best framework for that are quantum spin chains. Okay. So that's a bit the plan of these lectures. So let me go now to describing really the most simple random operator which you can think of, which is really Anderson's good old model of an operator on some kind of a graph. So in the following, G might be a graph. Actually, I'm a bit sloppy here. So G would be the vertices of the graph, and I'm just ignoring the edges in my notation. And the Hilbert space which I want to work with is the space of square summable sequences of the vertices of this graph. Okay, in this Hilbert space, I'm going to install a random operator which consists of two parts. Now, the first part is entirely non-random, and from a physical point of view, models hopping of electrons in this solid. In this, you can think of the graph being, for example, ZD, so having some kind of a crystalline structure. I want to take somehow the simplest hopping, which would be nearest neighbor hopping, so I'm just taking the adjacency operator on that graph. Okay, so I can it acts on a psi. Psi is an element in this L2 space. Okay, so psi is a function, and you can think of a function which assigns every lattice point here a complex value in such a way that the modulus squared of these complex values are summable over my graph. And A of psi is really just the sum over the at a vertex x, say here, over the neighboring lattice sides. So in this CD, which for d equal to 2 as is drawn here, if this is x, y, the sum of y would range over the four vertices being just adjacent to this vertex x. Okay. So that's a non-random object. You'll be probably familiar with that in your course on maybe functional analysis or graph theory. So suppose, let me talk about this later. Okay, so to add some randomness, one can pursue sort of many ideas, but the simplest one would be to just think of the randomness being created from some kind of random potential. Now, what is a potential? A potential somehow on this L2 space is just a multiplication operator, and I'm multiplying by values v of x attached to the vertices, and these values are now taken random. And the simplest process on my graph is just IID random variables on this graph. So for simplicity, things can be boosted up to much more general distributions. But just for simplicity of this talk, let me always suppose that the probability distribution of one of those variables is taken to be absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure, and that its density, which I'm going to call rho, is bounded. Okay. And also, somehow, since I don't want to make too much fuss with technicalities, I'm going to take the shortcut of stating my result always in the case when the support of this probability distribution is compact. Okay. All of that may be generalized, but I want to keep things simpler. Now, in order to tune up randomness, since I want to keep this probability distribution fixed, I introduce another parameter, which is just a real parameter lambda, without loss of generality, always greater than zero or equal to zero sometimes, which for fixed probability distribution then scales with the disorder strength. So this lambda is there to say, this term dominates or this term dominates. This term being dominant for lambda large, this term dominant for lambda small. Okay, what is the basic question in this game? So now you can easily show that the operator which I've installed is a bounded self-adjoint operator. So if this is a bounded self-adjoint operator, the simplest thing which we can do is spectral theory. Okay, so what I'm going to ask about first is what is the spectrum of this operator? Now, what would you guess? Here comes the first question to you. So if lambda is equal to zero, and my graph is ZD, the regular lattice, what would you guess would be the spectrum of this operator? Or what have you learned? Now see, then we're exactly in the situation which physicists describe as an ideal solid, which is a translation invariant operator. It's invariant to all lattice shifts if G is really ZD. Okay, so but in this case, all eigenfunctions are what? The good old Bloch waves, e to the ikx, where k ranges over the Brillouin zone, so the reciprocal lattice of Zd. Okay, now you can work things out, and let me show this on the next slide. You can work things out showing that the usual Bloch-Floquet analysis from function analysis works. Who has never heard of Bloch-Floquet analysis? Aha, probabilists in the audience. Okay, so maybe I should I mean, I have these exercises. I mean, so maybe we should do this in the exercise session. The basic idea, you know, is, I mean, so you have generalized eigenfunctions psi of x, which look as e to the I k dot x, where k is somehow in the Brillouin zone. So the reciprocal lattice, and we have z to the d, which would be something like e minus pi pi and the torus e to the d. Okay. If you plug this in, you can see that these things will actually reproduce and the eigenvalue will have something to do with the cosine. Okay, so for example, we take d equal to 1, right? So what is it if you plug it in? You get so e to the I k plus k of x plus 1 plus e to the I k of x minus 1, right, which is equal to e to the I k x times something like 2 times the cosinus of k. Okay. So that's an eigenfunction. Granted, it's not in the Hilbert space, so you have to mumble something about Fourier analysis here in order to make this rigorous, but that shows to you that indeed, somehow when lambda is equal to 0, here we are, the spectrum of this guy is just the interval which is given by 2 times cosine k, where k ranges over minus pi to pi in case d equal to 1. And that's this band from minus 2 to 2. Okay? So the whole interval here will be filled up by spectral values in case lambda is equal to 0. Okay, now from your functional analysis course, you might or might not have learned the distinction that if one studies spectra of self-adjoint operators, then one can ask for a refined question. Namely, remember, there's the Lebesgue theorem for measures. You can decompose every measure according to an absolutely continuous part with respect to Lebesgue, something which is singular continuous and something which is pure point. Okay, corresponding to this decomposition is a decomposition of the whole spectrum of a self-adjoint operator. So every spectrum of a self-adjoint operator H can be decomposed into an absolutely continuous part, a pure point part, and a singular continuous part. Okay. Now, as it turns out, in case lambda is equal to 0, the first thing which we need to understand, then the spectrum of this operator would be purely absolutely continuous. Now, absolutely continuous spectra are singled by non-square integral, or continuous spectra are singled by non-square integrable eigenfunction. Right? And that's what we have here. This is a non-square integrable beast. Okay, so down here, we have this band of absolutely continuous spectrum. And now the question from this random operator perspective, the first question which you can ask is now what happens if I switch on lambda? Okay. And the striking thing, what will happen is that, well, just like in statistical mechanics, things are actually dimension dependent. It's not only dependent on the strength of the disorder, but it's also dimension dependent. Okay, so so there's a bit of theory which I'm not going to go into, and I want you to just, because for time reasons, otherwise I cannot talk about exciting stuff. There's a bit of theory which I want you to swallow, and I'll give you a reference in the very end, which is the following. Well, see, in principle, you might think, oh, this is a random operator, so all of the spectra should be random, right? This should depend on the realization. Now, however, in case you're on a lattice, that's not true. Okay, so you have shifts on the lattice, and things are not translation invariant, but they are translation invariant on average. What does that mean? Well, see, if I take a realization of the random potential, some values on this lattice, Zd, and I shift everything, this would be a valid realization of the random potential. Okay, now if I shift everything, this operator will then be unitarily equivalent to the original random operator. Since it's unitarily equivalent, the spectra will agree. Okay. So essentially, it's from this perspective, not utterly surprising that the spectrum as a set and also the components in the Lebesgue decomposition, they are actually non-random. And that is a consequence for general, you can take this IID random potential, but you could also just switch to an ergodic process on ZD, okay? And ergodicity will ensure that the spectra and all of the components of the spectra are non-random objects. Okay, so what we will prove, or we will not prove the whole story, don't worry. What we will prove is part of the following picture. If I now switch on lambda, which let's get to this value of lambda, and suppose rho is now just say the equidistribution between negative a half and a half. So the first question is, where is the spectrum as a set? Well, see, that requires a proof, but let me do some hand waving here, which already indicates how the real proof goes. So see, as you're a probabilist, you certainly know that on this lattice ZD, there will be arbitrarily large regions where the random potential now is just very close to being negative one-half, to being a constant, any constant somehow in this interval. Now, what happens if I take an operator and add a constant? Well, it just shifts the spectrum, right? So you're going to create, if I subtract minus one-half, I'm just going to shift this interval to minus negative a half up there. But all these states, which I then can reach with lambda times negative one-half, they will be in the spectrum. Why is that? I can just create so-called wild sequences, that is approximate eigenfunctions, which I accommodate in these large regions where the potential is very close to being that constant value, and therefore this value is realized in the spectrum. Okay. So I can tell this story for any value, and therefore we have now sort of understood why the spectrum is indeed nothing else but the spectrum of this adjacency matrix, which is this interval here, just augmented by lambda times a half and minus lambda times a half on two sides. And everything in between, all spectral values will be realized. Okay, so these lines here are the boundaries of the almost true spectrum. Then the next question is, that's an easy exercise actually. That you can prove without doing anything. That's basically sort of constructing close sort of approximate eigenstates to realize that this is true. Now here comes the hard question, namely, compute the spectral decomposition. So tell me what is the AC part of that spectrum, what is the pure point part of the spectrum, and what is the singular continuous part of that spectrum. That is now not so easy at all. And the prediction by physicists is the following, that, as I said, the exciting thing is this all depends on the dimension. And in dimension one and two, it is extremely striking that in independent of how large the disorder is, the continuous part of the spectrum will just go away. So in other words, if I just move to lambda being arbitrarily tiny but positive here, all the spectrum is pure point for d equal to 1 and d equal to 2. Now, this is really a quantum effect, because think about it. You know, if you have a classical particle which moves on a slightly roughened line, because it moves in a potential which is a bit sort of rough, then if you just give it enough energy, then the particle can escape to infinity, right? Because it just rumbles over all of this roughness. Quantum mechanics says now that's not true anymore for a quantum particle. This quantum particle will be trapped. So if you take an arbitrarily sort of soft but still random surface, a quantum particle in one dimension will be trapped. Okay, there's only pure point spectrum, there's only bound states. I explain this sort of what this has to do with bound states later, but that's the striking thing which should surprise you. Okay, this happens to be true also in two dimensions. In starting with three dimensions, the picture changes. And what physicists predict is that there is actually a so-called mobility edge for small disorder lambda. When you take the spectrum at the edges of this interval, there will be only pure point spectrum, no transport. We'll see Poisson level statistics. But there will be a bubble of AC states, transport, and so-called random matrix statistics for this problem. Okay. That's the big picture which physicists paint. Okay. Now, the purpose of this talk is to show you that once I go off enough here, that all the states are localized. And that's what we will see somehow in these two lectures. That's the complete proof which I will give. Okay, but that is the challenge. And I should say, as I will remark in the very end, is we have absolutely no idea about how to grasp this inner point. There's a very good understanding how to grasp pure point spectrum, absence of transport, Poisson level statistics. But this regime really escapes us. Okay. That's one of the reasons why I'm not saying anything about this. Okay, now let's go to the math. So as I said, the task will be to show that all these things here occur at least at sufficiently high disorder in arbitrary dimensions. Now, how do we go about that? Well, okay, so here's your rough reminder on spectral theory. So remember, all the spectral information about a self-adjoint operator H is encoded in the resolvent, which is the inverse of this operator. Of course, I can only take the inverse away from the spectrum. The spectrum of a self-adjoint operator is a subset of the real line, therefore, I'm being a bit cautious here and just taking things sort of off the real line. And since I'm working on a small L2 space, the particular functions which are associated to lattice sites X, which have the property that they are 1 if Y is equal to X and 0 else, these are L2 functions. Okay, so these would be the evaluation functionals, that's my notation before it. Now, they form a basis of this little L2 space when X runs through all of the vertices. So all information about this self-adjoint operator H is contained in the matrix elements of the resolvent in terms of this basis, and that is referred to as the Green's function. Now, what is spectral theory? Well, spectral theory is the theory in me about the measures associated through this Stieltjes relation to the operator H and an arbitrary selection of vectors, here x and y. Okay, so all information about the spectrum is contained in the spectral measure when x runs through the lattice sites. Okay, is that clear? So for example, the spectrum of H would be the union of the supports of the spectral measures associated with x and x. That is with the spectrum as a set. And then you can, if I ask about mu xx, that's a real valued Borel measure. I can do my Lebesgue decomposition. I can ask whether this is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue, singular continuous, or pure point. And depending on whether x has the property that this produces a pure point measure, singular continuous measure, x, this vector then spans part of the, or then creates in a certain way the absolutely continuous eigenstates, or singular continuous eigenstates, or pure point eigenstates. Okay? So this is what we're going to study is the Green's function, and as you will see, somehow all information can be about this random operator or non-random operator, but the self-adjoint operator can be recaptured from information about the Green's function. Now, since this spectral measures are just complex valued Borel measures, an important quantity which I want to look at in this lecture is the so-called eigenfunction correlator, also known to mathematicians as the total variation measure of these spectral measures. Now, this will be abbreviated by Qx in some Borel set I. The last equality is to give you an intuition, and also that was the quantity written down by physicists first, of what this guy is. Okay, so suppose somehow H is a matrix, right? So the matrix just consists of somehow some self-adjoint matrix. There are some eigenvalues which make up the spectrum, and there are some eigenfunctions. Let me call the normalized eigenvectors psi of E. Okay. So what would be first of all in the first exercise? So if H is a matrix of E1 up to En. Right, and let me suppose somehow they have simple eigenvalues J. In the so-called normalized eigenvectors, normalized is always we have a Hilbert space, so there's a scalar product and a norm, and I normalize it with respect to this norm. They would be called psi of Vj. Okay. So what would actually be the measure mu in this case as a first exercise? Well, I would sum over all eigenvalues in my Borel set I, and then I have a weight, and then this weight would be just equal to, let me see if I've done it right, psi e of x, psi e of y bar, where bar denotes complex conjugation. Okay? That would be the spectral measure of this simple matrix here. Okay, what is the total variation measure? where the total variation measure irgendwie of this discrete measure irgendwie is just what I wrote down here. Okay, you just take as weights the absolute values of the eigenfunction at x and y. And that's where this name eigenfunction correlator comes from. Now, why is this such an informative quantity? Well, because see, in quantum mechanics, we want to study quantum mechanical time evolution. The quantum mechanical time evolution is governed by the Schrödinger equation. The Schrödinger equation for those of you who have never seen that, that's IDT, that's a linear equation for a vector psi, and that's given by h of psi of t. Okay? Or in other words, the time-evolved state, or the time-evolved vector from just some vector in my Hilbert space, which at time zero psi naught is just the unitary operator generated by the self-adjoint operator h applied to psi naught. Okay, this is a unitary time evolution, so it preserves the norm in scalar products in my Hilbert space. That's sort of one of the defining features of the Schrödinger equation. Now, so suppose as my initial vector, I start something which is, well, I start my particle at a lattice point y. And suppose somehow energetically I restrict my time evolution to an energy window I. So what is this? This is the spectral projection of the self-adjoint operator H onto the Borel set I. Now, you could take the Schrödinger equation with that particular initial state. Then it would be time evolved to this state. Oh, and let me, sorry, something which I haven't said is, since I have a physics background, and since this is mathematical physics, the scalar product is linear in the second coordinate, not the first coordinate. So it's linear in that beast and not that beast. Okay. So if I start somehow with that vector, take my time evolution, and then ask, what is the probability of finding the quantum particle at point x in my graph? What would be this probability, where the probability, the probabilistic interpretation in quantum mechanics would be that psi zero of x squared would be the probability to find the quantum state described by psi zero at x. Okay, now you see somehow why we want normalized wave functions, because if this is supposed to be a probability, when you sum up over x in the graph, it better be one. Okay. So that's the probability, that's really the quantum probability of finding the particle which is modeled by this wave function psi naught at x in the graph. Okay, now absence of transport would be then the question that if I start here at y in my lattice, that's my y, and I consider a faraway x here, that even if I take the time evolution sort of for an arbitrarily long time, okay, that the modulus square of this beast will be small if x is far away from y. That is absence of transport. Okay, that is irgendwie somehow the quantity irgendwie which I want to control. Now, why is this inequality true? You see? Wait. See, so what is this? Right. This is this object here, and we can be. So let me take maybe the left hand side and re-express it in terms of the spectral measure. So what is it? Well, it's the integral over the spectral measure associated with x and y integrated over e. I is the energy interval to which I restrict everything. And then I take e to the minus I t e. That is indeed what the spectral theorem tells you. Okay. And now, I mean, this inequality is just pulling the absolute value inside and be the integral, right? It's just the trivial triangle inequality. I mean, that's what we are doing here. So controlling the eigenfunction correlator allows you to control the transport. And that is what this box tries to tell you. Now, I've started telling you about pure point spectra and all that jazz. So how do we go back to, if we now control the eigenfunction correlator and therefore the transport through this simple inequality, how do we control the spectral information? Well, here is a black box, which you might or might have not learned in your functional analysis course, which is a theorem which actually goes back only to the 70s. It's named Rage Theorem, after Ruel, Amrain, Georgescu, and Enns, who have contributed various parts of this. And it tells you that a quite physical thing, namely that the information about the spectrum is encoded, in fact, in the transport. So there's a one-to-one correspondence between transport information and spectra. And that goes as follows. Okay, so here's the Rage theorem in its simplest form. It's an abstract theorem on Hilbert spaces. Take a self-adjoint operator as our random operator, has nothing to do with randomness. And you take a sequence of compact operators which converge strongly to the identity. Okay, anybody who doesn't know what strong convergence is? I mean, don't be ashamed. This is functional analysis. So it basically means that for all psi in H, the limit of L tends to infinity of, here in this case, the limit is 1 of AL, that goes to 0. So we're measuring the convergence in the Hilbert space, norm of these vectors when you apply the operators to them. Okay, so it tells you, really there's a beautiful one-to-one correspondence between spectral information and transport information. And that goes as follows, namely, you measure the norm of the time-evolved vector psi when applied AL to it. And you require that in Cesaro average, when you first take the Cesaro average, so first take L to infinity and then take t to infinity and then take L to infinity, that this quantity goes to 0. Okay, in the vectors which will satisfy these this property, they are the vectors which contribute to the continuous spectrum of the self-adjoint operator. So they span the orthogonal subspace of continuous states. Okay, so the Hilbert space is an orthogonal sum of pure point states and continuous states. And the continuous states you may or may not subspan by absolutely continuous states and singular continuous states. Okay. That's how this works. Now, the point spectrum, they have the property that when you time evolve and ask about the remainder uniformly in time, this goes to zero when you blow up L. Now, what's the physical intuition behind this? So you can think of these ALs as if you're on my graph. So think of ZD. So let me now put more structure on this graph, namely, this is an infinite graph, say. And let me take AL as the projections to the balls of radius L. Okay. Now, so just a multiplication operator, which is 1 if x is inside L and 0 outside. That's the operator which I want to consider. When L tends to infinity, these projections clearly converge to 1 as L tends to infinity, because you eventually get the whole graph. And what is this statement then in concrete? Well, it says that a state from the continuous subspace has the property that its quantum probability, so this probability psi t, of x being in some set, that is by definition, so see, so I said the quantum probability of being at x is just psi of x squared, and the probability of finding the particle in B would be then the sum over x and B. Okay, so you take this time-evolved vector, and you ask, is the particle inside the box? Now, when upon Cesaro averaging and taking the box even arbitrarily large, it's not there, then you're sure it's a continuous state. That is very physical, because continuous states are the states which contribute to transport. So once you have such a state which is near here, then if you wait long enough, then it will just disappear from this room. That's what this says, at least upon Cesaro averaging. In contrast, when you take the pure point spectral states, they correspond to bound states. Namely, when you ask what this quantity here is, this is proportional to, it's sort of the square root of the quantum probability of not finding the particle in the ball of radius L, at least after time t, and it says that even if I look uniformly in t, when I make the box large enough, then this goes to zero. So in other words, if I have such a state which is at time zero here, then if I wait long enough, it will still remain in the vicinity of this room. Okay, that is what this Rage theorem tells you. And that should now somehow make a bit more explicit what I said before, namely that it is to us of interest whether states here are only bound states and therefore there is no transport, or states are only continuous states and therefore there is transport. It's kind of a one-to-one correspondence. Now, if you look closely, what physicists believe is in these operators, there is no singular continuous spectrum. So that's why there's not C, but AC here. Let me go back to this. Okay, now, so the first lecture will be, as I said, somehow proving an upper bound on the eigenfunction correlator. And I will do this by actually first proving an upper bound on the Green's function. And for this, I will just follow Anderson's original argument. Now, if you read Anderson's paper, there are all kinds of problems with this paper, but there's a beautiful idea here, which you as probabilist will actually appreciate. Now, see, if what we're aiming at is the regime when lambda is tremendously large. So as a first guess, you could think, one way to understand this resolvent of this operator is to say, oh, when lambda is large, let me forget about A, so let me treat A as a perturbation. Right? This is, in fact, not such a brilliant idea in general, but for large disorder, it works. Now, how do we do perturbation theory in function analysis? Well, we apply the really only equation which is suited for that, which is the resolvent equation, which, since I've included a minus A in H, that's how it reads. It's with a plus sign. So you could say, to first approximation, the perturbed resolvent is the unperturbed one, which is just V's. And then there's the first order perturbation. Now, of course, first order perturbation doesn't give you anything because there's still this unknown quantity here. So let us just expand until somehow everything, just expand and we write down the full Norfolk-Neumann series. Iterate and be this resolvent equation. So what will you get? Well, in fact, what you get is something which will probably show up in other talks. And I want to do this and be sort of careful. So let's take the first equation and let's now somehow put matrix elements on them. This is something which you should really understand. So what's the first term? Well, the first term is the XY matrix element of a multiplication operator. But that we know what it is, right? Because if I take the inverse of a multiplication operator, it's still a multiplication operator. So it's diagonal in this given basis of states. And it multiplies by V of X minus C. Okay, so what else do we have? Well, we have plus. So what is A? So let me see, if I come here with an X, there's a multiplication operator, it will throw out V of X minus Z. And then we have delta X A 1 over H minus Z delta Y, right? So what is A? A, by definition, was the sum over W with a property that they are neighbors to X. Okay. The matrix element, the XY matrix element of A, was normalized to 1. So what we end up here is a full resolvent of the perturbed operator. Okay. So this is what I get when I take matrix element on the first equation. And if I iterate this thing, of course, what I will get is what? Well, I will then somehow accumulate an expansion where I start in X, then eventually I will end up in Y, and at each step, I'm just going to make somehow steps of size 1, and I accumulate factors of 1 over lambda times the potential at that side where I am minus E. That's what I will end up with. I can go back. But eventually, when I just expand everything out, there's a minus sign, wrong on this slide, I eventually erase this, so kill this minus sign. Because I got confused when preparing this. So you get all the matrix elements. In general, if you put another operator A here, that's what it is. But since these are adjacency matrices, I really get only walks of step one. And I accumulate for each walk gamma, I accumulate factors of the term 1 over lambda times, there's a lambda missing here, minus c. Okay, now what's the intuition? So first of all, the first thing which you may ask is this expansion convergent. That's sort of unfortunately no in general. However, we have this free parameter z, and if z has the property that the imaginary part of z is bigger than the magnitude of those guys A here, of the operator norm of A, then you can easily see somehow that this is a convergent sum. By the way, one thing which I also, for those of you who have never seen that, there's always a priori bound for a self-adjoint operator, which bounds the norm of h minus z, and also somehow in the case where h is just a multiplication operator in terms of 1 over the modulus of the imaginary part, for h self-adjoint. Okay, that's how you see that this is a convergent expansion, at least if we take the imaginary part large enough. Let's suppose this for the moment. We're anyway repeating only Anderson's argument, it's hand waving. Now, what would you say? Now you have all kinds of expansions from x to y. Now, the intuition is basically the v of x, that's now a random process. And as long as the degree of this graph is smaller than lambda times v of x minus z, this is in fact a convergent expansion. Because see, the entropy which you're accumulating in this expansion is you're always accumulating degree many terms here. But as long as somehow in modulus this kills the degree, this is a convergent expansion, which in fact is more than convergent. It produces factors which are smaller than one. So as long as the degree is smaller than the modulus of the inverses here, you get just decay in each step. And that's why what will come out of that is an exponential decay of this Green's function. Now, okay, so that's how Anderson proved exponential decay of the Green's function. There's, of course, something wrong with that, where there's the small print that this expansion is a bit not convergent here. At least somehow for z's where we're interested in the Green's function, namely that's next to the real axis. That the Green's function decays exponentially off the real axis, I don't need Anderson for that. That's just abstract function analysis. So that's a bit the first problem. Then if we ignore the convergence of this expansion, the next problem, if we take now z to be real or close to real, is that of course not every v of x will stay away from e. Okay, so there will be resonant spots in this expansion when you accumulate. Now here's a rescue. So the first thing which as a probabilist you can ask is how bad if you take z real, how bad is the blow up on a spot where things now explode? Okay. Well, how bad it is. Namely, the probability that this 1 over the modulus of lambda vx minus some constant is bigger than t, that's the same as saying lambda vx minus alpha stays smaller than 1 over t. And since I assumed that my probability distribution was absolutely continuous with a bounded density, it's proportional to 1 over t. Of course, it's also proportional to 1 over lambda. Okay, so let me tell you this just already in advance. This is a weak L1 bound, as you know. And the weak L1 bound in particular entails that if you take these potentially singular denominators to a fractional power, to some power s smaller than 1, then things are actually integrable. Okay, so the singularities which appear in these expansions are not so bad. And in particular, somehow things go down with the disorder strength. There's always a 1 over lambda which makes these probabilities small. Now, okay, now but we have to deal with the fact that these expansions which Anderson writes down at first are not convergent in the regime Z close to the real axis where we want to look at. And there's a technique which you as probabilists might have guessed, which in your language would just be the statement that, let me now loop erase this expansion. So instead of summing over all walks which connect x to y, let me loop erase things and sum over self-avoiding walks. Now, this again, the same misprint, so you just ignore these factors minus 1, which I killed eventually. So what would be the idea of this loop erasure? Where was my... Yes, let me put it here. Okay, see, let me not use the... let me not use the normal resolvent equation, but actually let me kill in this operator starting from x all matrix elements which connect x to the outside world, to the rest of the lattice. So in two dimensions, let me kill these four terms. Now, if x is not equal to y, then the corresponding resolvent equation would read as follows. Okay, so now the perturbation is not anymore in A, but the perturbation is now in these orange bonds. So it's only part of A in which I'm expanding. Okay, it's only somehow these four terms which I'm erasing in the first step. So what would be it? Well, see, if you think about it, sort of loop erasing this, you could have come back somehow to x. And loop erasing this would be meaning that, you wait until you last exit x. In terms of the functional analysis statement is that you take the resolvent equation, erase this here, and out pops the Green's function from x to x. So the first step is not anymore 1 over v of x, but it's the full Green's function. And then you connect to a hopping neighboring x. Let me call this v here. And then from v, we continue with the rest of the operator, which would be then everything which lives in the complement of x. So just take the operator on the complement of x. So g, just subtract x from it. Call this Green's function as such, and that's your loop erased version. Once you iterate this, what you will accumulate then is not factors of 1 over v of x here, but what you will accumulate is factors of full resolvents, but which always work in the complement of the path up to time k. Okay, and that is called the Feinberg expansion. Now, what about its convergence? Well, its convergence is wonderful, because as you know, if we go now to a finite graph, there's just a finite number of terms in the sum. can only be a finite number of self-avoiding graphs, self-avoiding walks irgendwie on a finite graph. So in a finite graph, I can even take z arbitrarily close to the real axis and do this. It's just a finite sum. Now, the argument which I have to make in order to prove that g decays exponentially is that these factors here, which I accumulate, will be typically very small. Small in comparison to what? Where the entropy is still the same. The entropy in each step is the degree which we're getting from this expansion. So here comes the proof. In principle, the full proof that for large disorder, the Green's function decays exponentially. It's this slide. Okay, so let's take the one-step resolvent equation, which results from erasing those orange hoppings. Now, let's average this Green's function or the modulus of this Green's function with respect to disorder. That's this capital E here. And for reasons which will be clear in a minute, I don't want to take the Green's function, the average of the modulus of the Green's function, but I rather want to take a fractional moment. Fractional moment means S smaller than 1. Now, apply triangles inequality to that and use the fact that I've set things up such that the modulus of A is equal to 1. What you will arrive at is a sum over the diagonal Green's function times a problem which looked like the problem before. You have to still walk from V to Y in the complement of X. Now, this is now an expected value of the product. Wouldn't it be for this product, and would this expected value factorize? One could argue as follows. Let me take the expected value of the Green's function of this diagonal term which pops up here. Okay, so now I claim that when lambda is large, this scales as 1 over lambda to the s. And I'll show you this somehow in a moment. Now, I claim even further, even when I condition on everything, aside from the random variable at x, where for brevity of this slide, I abbreviate this conditional expectation of e of x, that's just this integral here, I have iit random variables, then this integral is bounded by 1 over lambda to the s. Take this for granted, and in this expected value, we now just integrate over v of x. Now see, because I set things up in this Feinbergish way, the second factor here, that plays cool under this average, because it does not depend on v of x. That's the resolvent in the complement. So indeed, it's not an expected value of a product which I have to compute, it's just an expected value of a single factor. And this is bounded by 1 over lambda to the s. That's what I inserted, and what I get is, I get a sum, so there's a certain entropy in this expansion. I get an expected value of a gadget which looks as the thing which I originally looked at. But I got now this factor of 1 over lambda, and now iterate this thing. Iterate it how many times? Iterate it the distance of x to y times. In each step, I get, degree many terms of the graph times a factor of 1 over lambda to the s. If the degree times this factor here is smaller than 1, iteration just gets you an exponential decay. Right? That's what you get. So, what I show to you is an argument, actually a rigorous argument, why when lambda is large enough, the Green's function decays exponentially. And you know what the decay rate is. I mean, the decay rate is given in terms of lambda in the degree of the graph in this explicit form. Okay, so this relied on observation, it relied actually, if you think about it, on two observations. Namely, the first observation is that this factor here was, even when I only integrate on V of x, bounded by Cs times divided by lambda to the s, and it, if you think about it sort of a bit closer, it also relied on the fact that these quantities here are a priori bounded by a constant. Right? Because when I iterate, eventually I'll have to throw away the last term. And how do I throw away the last term? Well, I throw it away because I know it's bounded. I don't want to show to you how at the moment why these things are bounded, but you know, when x is equal to y, I will show to you why they are bounded. And that is this lemma here. Now, what's the magic behind this lemma? So here is something which, if you haven't seen this before, that is actually the heart of, I would say, 30% of papers on problems on graphs. And a lot of other things. Now, see, what we are left when we want to prove this inequality, basically you have to ask yourself, how does the potential of it, how does this omega of x enter this Green's function? So how does it depend on it? Now, that is the question which in abstract ways can be framed as follows. So see, H is an operator which is some H naught plus lambda Vx times a rank one projection onto the vector delta x. I'm going to write this rank one projection in this physicist-y way. Okay. And basically, what I'm asking is, let me call this P. So basically, the question which I'm asking is, how does the resolvent of H look in the subspace P? Because this is nothing else but delta x 1 over H minus z delta x P. Okay, so that's the question which I'm asking. Now here's a general theorem which I think it's worth learning about, which is very old. It's called Krein-Fischbach-Schur formula. It answers the question that when you take a self-adjoint operator in some Hilbert space, you have an orthogonal projection, can be rank one or not rank one, it doesn't matter. You add to this self-adjoint operator, so think of this as H naught, an operator which just lives in that subspace P. Right? That's what this identity here says. And then the resolvent on that subspace of the perturbed operator is nothing else but the resolvent of the unperturbed operator on that subspace, modified by a by an inverse, and that's now an inverse only on that subspace PH of an operator K, which depends on Z, which happens to be just the projected version of the resolvent. Okay. Now, this is a general fact of life. It is a very useful identity, and one thing which I want you to do is think about somehow how one would prove this, at least for matrices. Now, once we proved this, we can answer how GXX depends, right? Why? Well, because let us just take P of X, P, what I suggested here. Then this operator A is really this creature here. And it says that the full resolvent, once I project it from both sides on this one-dimensional subspace, that is nothing else but the operator K times the inverse of 1 plus A. What is A in this case? Well, A is nothing else but lambda V of XP times K times P. So in other words, GXX is of that form, with a quantity alpha, which we're going to look at closer, it can actually be identified. So this alpha of z, this is nothing else but 1 over minus the XX matrix element of H naught. In this case here. Well, but once you know that this is true, of course you know that the that once you integrate over v of x, this integral is bounded. That's what I showed to you in this inequality. We have a weak L1 bound, so every fractional moment is bounded. Okay, it deteriorates once you go to s equal to 1, but that doesn't matter, right? Because we can stay at any fractional moment. Okay, so I will hand out these slides and we think about how to prove this. It's an easy exercise and that's just a very small corollary. How much time do I have? I think I'm going infinitely slow. Okay, so what I showed to you is the argument why the fractional moment of the Green's function decays exponentially even if z is arbitrarily close to the real axis. Because remember, in this whole argument here, the bound which you get is independent of z, of the complex energy where you are. Okay, so we have such an inequality independent of z, and the remainder of what we have to show in order to show absence of transport and absence of continuous spectrum is in fact, we have to go to this eigenfunction correlator. So the next step in the proof of, in fact, this theorem here is to convert the bound on the Green's function to a bound on the eigenfunction correlator. And if we would succeed, we would then have proven that at large disorder, there's no transport, there's no continuous spectrum. So they can only be, if there's spectrum, there's only pure point spectrum. Now, this result, as it stands, was for d equal to 1 proven by Kunzu-Ya. In fact, actually also, looking at the eigenfunction correlator, for arbitrary d, it was proven in this form, first by Eisenman, using exactly, not exactly, but more or less, somehow, the method, which I talked about. Now, I should say, somehow, this method is known, under the name fractional moment method. One of its beauties is its simplicity. As you see, we can really go through the full proof. And if you're only interested in Green's functions, then the full proof is really just more or less one slide. There are other techniques to prove localization. And we see localization is basically what are you trying to do? Well, localization is this phenomenon that when you think about this path expansions of the Green's functions, one shocking thing to probabilists is, of course, the quantities which are involved there are not non-negative. These are now complex quantities which you have to sum up. But what you have to show is that since there's enough somehow randomness in these path expansions, the blow-ups which are there, they are there because we are looking at the Green's function in the spectrum, so there will be resonances in these systems, and these are physical, because the phenomenon which you try to defeat is that you could have an eigenstate which lives here, and then by quantum tunneling you can move over there. So these resonances which you experience in these expansions, they're completely physical. And you have to see that because of this self-avoidingness of the path, the environment is always refreshed. And that's why these resonances really don't play such a tremendous role, at least for large disorder. Okay, that's the phenomenon of localization in a mathematical proof. Controlling these resonances was done not by looking at an integrated version of the Green's function, but by probabilities that these blow-ups are severe or not so severe in a multiscale analysis. And that was the original proof by Froehlich and Spencer, who could actually prove the decay of the Green's function, but couldn't go the last step to really prove the absence of transport. Okay. Good. So the remainder of the probably I will take I'm infinitely slow of this lecture also tomorrow I will spend now on showing how to go from the Green's function to the eigenfunction correlator. That's an important step in order to control the really absence of transport. Now, this eigenfunction correlator is a very fundamental quantity. It's the total variation measure of the spectral measure. So it's actually good to pause here and collect some of its properties. You know, I was at points sort of cheating and telling you, this expansion with a Feinberg expansion that self-adjoining walks, this is all convergence, so we don't have to worry because we can go to a finite volume. Well, ultimately, we're interested in the infinite volume. So one of the things which you should understand is if I take my Hamiltonian, just cut off the graph to a finite box, say, what's the relation of the eigenfunction correlator on the finite box to the eigenfunction correlator in the infinite system? And here's an unfortunate fact. This quantity is lower semi-continuity in this cutoff. So if you prove bounds for finite volume, they're inherited by the infinite volume limit. That's just a general fact of life that when you take a sequence of operators which converge in the strong resolvent sense, their total variation measures, they're at least somehow following this lower semi-continuity for open sets, and that's enough. Okay, strong resolvent convergence, I don't know if I should say something about this. Basically, this is the weak convergence of the associated spectral measures. That is what makes this proof work. Okay, now, what's the relation of the eigenfunction correlator to the Green's function? There's a lot to say. The easiest thing which you can say is, in fact, it's a singular limit. Namely, if we're on a finite graph, and remember, I can always resort to finite graphs, then the eigenfunction correlator of a bounded interval is in fact nothing else but the Green's function, its fractional moment integrated over that interval. Take somehow a singular, this will blow up, but why will this blow up? Let me just a second. Do I have some blackboards still? Presumably not. But let me try it here. to see, I mean, somehow, why will this blow up? I mean, well, what does, if I'm on a finite graph, I mean, H is a matrix. So what is gxy? It's z, or at any energy e. Well, this is nothing else simply but the sum of the eigenvalues ej, right, of 1 over ej minus e. And then there's a certain weight, and the weight is just the normalized eigenfunction at x and its complex conjugate at y. Okay, now once, so now if e doesn't hit any one of those eigenvalues, simply this is a well-defined quantity, it's a finite sum over any non-singular terms. Now, but once I integrate over e, basically any what you're integrating here when you take the modulus is a 1 over x singularity. That is not such a good idea. However, if you plug in a fractional moment, and we then suddenly a 1 over x singularity becomes integrable. Right? So once s is smaller than 1, this gadget here, once you integrate over e, this is finite. As long as s is smaller than 1. Now, what is claimed here is that when you take the limit s tends to 1, what you will effectively get out here is the moduli, is the sum of the moduli over these two terms. Why is that clear? We will mentally decompose this interval here. So here's an eigenvalue, that's E1, that's E2. Decompose this interval in terms of maybe somehow INs, or I1, I2, which are sort of centered and equidistant to the next eigenvalue. Okay. Now, from this integration over I1, So in this sum, all terms, once you integrate over I1, we are non-singular when ej is not e1. So in the limit s tends to 1, this will give 0, right? This is part of the integration. Now, once you pick out one of those singular terms, what you have to check, and you can check this, is that once I integrate just one of those factors, the normalization is done in such a way that I really get a Kronecker delta. So that I really get 1 as long as m is equal to I1. And that's how you pick out these terms, which are equal to the eigenfunction correlator. Okay, so the eigenfunction correlator is not an alien object to the Green's function, it's a singular limit. Unfortunately, if we now sort of take expected values, take Fatou's lemma, we could think of somehow just finishing the proof, but that doesn't work because once you look at what we've proved here, there's this annoying quantity C of S, and C of S was quite explicit. This is sort of a bound on these integrals here, which you cannot really improve, and they blow up with S tending to 1. Now, you might say, well, but I have a factor 1 over 1 minus S in front. Yes, you do have this, but unfortunately also mu of S then goes to 0, and then you will lose your exponential decay. So directly using this simple observation doesn't get us anywhere. And that's why we have to be a bit smarter than that and turn another crank and investigate a bit closer the relations of Green's function and eigenfunctions. And I think I will do this tomorrow.
Are there any questions? Okay.
So the random wall expansion, actually, the fact that image of Z is greater than, it's not a necessary condition.
No.
Actually, it always is actually converged very close to the real axis.
Yes, you can actually, sure. Okay, so. Okay, so his comment is about that I was a bit too timid here. That is actually true. You can say more about this, but still this doesn't really solve your problem. Because, so in some sense, somehow that's a red herring. Indeed, the convergence can be taken under control. However, what's really wrong with this expansion is, and you see this somehow in this picture, once you take non-self-avoiding walks, in this lattice, there will be these resonance spots where lambda v of x minus the energy where you want to look at is actually much, much larger than the degree of the graph. Okay? And once you take a non self-avoiding expansion, you cannot avoid somehow going back to these resonance spots over and over again. And that's just a not very good idea. So what you should at least do, you should avoid all those blow-up points in this expansion in order to see exponential decay, right? Excuse me, yes. Sorry. Yes, much, much smaller than that. Because that is what's going to kill you, the argument why this decays exponentially. Once you run into these resonance spots, and if you're in an infinite system, there will be an infinite number of those guys. And if you don't take care of your expansion, in a better way than just running into these resonance spots over and over again, you're doomed. So that's why somehow taking at least a soft form of avoiding resonances is necessary for any of those ideas to work. And the Feinberg expansion is somehow the most dramatic version that you never come back to the site which you visited before.
Other questions? No more? Let's thank the speaker again.